Trying to see the design procedure of flange coupling. So this flange coupling consists of shaft, key and flange, and this you connect these two shafts with help of two flanges, and these two flanges are connected by the number of bolts along the circumference of these flanges. And here, so the design of this flange coupling consists of design of individual parts, that is design of shaft, design of key and design of this flange. And in also in this design of flange, we have to design the hub and also design the flange separately. Even though it is only single part, so while designing, we will consider that design of hub is different, design of this flange part is different, and also design of bolt. So now let us see the design of shaft. See here, you know, if design of shaft, design of shaft. So design of shaft means finding out the diameter, that is small d, let us assume. So if the power and RPM n is given, we can find out the diameter of the shaft. How? So you know, P is equals to 2 pi n t by 60, and also you can write these many watts, and t is equals to 60 p by 2 pi n. So from this, if you know power and if you know RPM, you can find out torque. And if you know find out torque, and also you can find out diameter. How? See, torque is equals to pi by 16 tau d cube. So this is the torque transmitted by a solid circular shaft. So if you know the shear stress, allowable shear stress of the shaft material, you can find out the diameter here if you substitute the torque value from here. So just see that if the power is given in the watts, you have to you will get torque value in Newton meter. But if you want to get the diameter of the shaft in mm, you have to substitute the torque value here, Newton mm. So to convert that, you know that 1 meter is equals to 1000 mm. So that is, I can write that it has 10 to the power of 3 Newton mm, such that this meter is converted to mm. So that value you have to substitute here to get the diameter in the mm. So this is the design of the shaft. So next thing is design of key. So here, design of keys. The second step is design of keys. So this design of key consists of, first of all, let us assume we are using a rectangular key. So rectangular key means it is cross section is rectangle. Let us assume that this is W and this is T. And first of all, we'll assume the dimensions of this key and we'll check for the induced stresses. So let us assume that W, that is width of the key, is equals to D by 4 mm if you take diameter in mm, and thickness of key is equals to D by 6 mm where D is the diameter of the shaft, and length of the key. So see here, so the length of the key is at least the length of the hub. So because this key is provided or it is inserted in this hub portion, so the length of the key is at least the length of the hub, so that is can be taken as 1.5 times of D here. So these are the usual proportions you can observe here. Outside diameter of the hub, so I told that this is a hub and this is nothing but outside diameter of the hub, that can be taken as capital D, that is 2 times of D, where D is the diameter of the shaft, and that is also inside diameter of the hub. And length of the hub, L is equals to 1.5 D, this is nothing but length of the hub. And pitch circle diameter of the bolts, that is we are taking the symbol as D1, that is taken as 3 times of D. So this will become pitch circle diameter. The pitch circle diameter means where the bolts are placed along the circumference of these flanges. And D2 is the outside diameter of the flange. So this will become D2, that is, we'll take it as 4 times of D. And here, the thickness of flange, this is thickness of flange that can be taken as 0.5 times of D. And here, we'll arrange these bolts in the circumference, along the circumference of this flange, so that number of bolts N can be taken as 3 for the diameters up to 40 mm. And this number of bolts, you have to use 4 bolts for diameters up to 100 mm. Number of bolts, we have to use 6 bolts for the diameters up to 180 mm. So these are the usual proportions we will use in the design of flange coupling. So here, so from this length of the key can be taken as 1.5 times of D. 1.5 times of D if you take D in mm. So these are the proportions. First of all, we will assume for the key, and we have to check this key for against the stresses induced in the key. And first of all, in the first step, we have to check that check for shear stress induced in the key. So why we have to check for the shear stress induced in the key, or why shear stress is developed in the key? So see here, so when we give power from this side, so this shaft is trying to rotate, and this shaft and this hub are connected by this key. So this shaft will apply a tangential force on the key. So see here, shaft is there, and we have placed a key here, and when it is rotating, this shaft will apply a tangential force in this key, such that it is trying to cut the key. If you see other view, so it is trying to cut, and if you see the top view, so this is the area which is taking the shear force, or which is subjected to shear force. That is nothing but W into L. So in this way, when the shaft is trying to rotate, so this will apply a shear force on the key, such that the key gets sheared off, such that shear stress is induced in the key. So we have to check for the shear stress induced in the key. So why? Because already we have assumed the dimensions, some of the dimensions for the key, width, thickness and length. So the next step is to check for the stresses induced. So see that how to check for the stresses induced. So you can check this as, so here when you are giving the torque input, each and every element in this coupling has to transmit the same amount of torque, or you can say that each and every element in this flange has to withstand the same amount of torque. So here, if you write the torque transmitted by this key by considering the shear stress, you can write, you know, basic formula of torque is nothing but force into radius, and radius is, see here, this key is approximately placed at a distance of small d by 2. See, if you assume here it is a small d, and this is approximately placed at a distance of small d by 2. So this R will become small d by 2. And force, this force is can be written as stress into area. And how can you write this force stress into area? You know, stress is equals to load by area, and load can be taken as force also, and it is force by area. So you can write this force as stress into area. So from that we have written the force in the place of force, we have written stress into area. So stress, what kind of stress we are taking? Shear stress. So you have to write here shear stress tau and area. So this W into L is the area which is subjected to shear. So that is, we can write it as W into L into D by 2. So here torque. So torque we have calculated already in the first step itself. So this is the torque amount. So I told that same amount of torque is to be transmitted by each and every element. If you substitute this torque here, and W is, we can find out W from this proportion. We have to substitute W value here and the length value here, and D value we have calculated in the first step, and this is torque is also known. So here unknown thing is shear stress induced in the key. So that will be find out from this equation. So this shear stress induced in the key must be less than the shear stress allowable. And also in the second step we have to, so in the second step we have to check for the, crushing stress induced in the key. Crushing stress induced in the key. So while you are taking the crushing stress as a criteria, so from in that criteria also you have to write the torque formula. So that is nothing but same basic formula, force into radius and stress into area into this radius is d by 2. And stress, what kind of stress here? Crushing stress we are taking, so you have to write here sigma c. And area, so see here, so when you place this key, in the shaft. So if you see the side view, this will be look like this. So we'll place this key like this. So this is the shaft surface. So this shaft surface is applying compressive force on the key. So if you see that separately, so this is the key and compressive force is applied on the surface of the key. So on which surface it is applied, if you see one more side view, so this is T we have taken and this is length. See, so on this half of the surface you can observe here. So here this is the surface of the shaft which is applying compressive force on this half of this surface of the key. So that surface, you can see that this is T we have taken and this is the length of the key. So the area will become this area, and this area can be written as T by 2. This is T by 2 one dimension and this is L. So this is the area which is subjected to crushing. So here area you have to write as T by 2 into L and into D by 2. So here, so T from these relations, you can substitute the T value. From this relation you can substitute the T value, and from this relation you can substitute L value here, and here torque you can substitute from the first step. So here we already calculated torque here, and I told that torque must be same for each and every element. So you can substitute torque here, same value, and sigma c you have to find out induced shear stress from this equation. So this induced shear stress must crushing stress I'm sorry it is induced crushing stress must be less than the crushing stress allowable. So this completes the design of key. And next step, if you see, so that is nothing but design of hub. I told that this is only one part, that is hub and flange are connected and this is only one part, but while designing you have to design this as separately. This means this hub is one part and this flange is one part, you have to design separately. So if you see that, so now the next step is design of hub. You see here, if you see the separately this flange, so this is the flange, you can see it separately. So this is the inside diameter of this. Here up to here we will consider it as hub, and this portion we will take it as flange. So once again I am telling, this is no doubt this is only one part, but while designing we will design this as separately. This will treat as separate part, that is hub, and this is flange. So now if you see, so this is nothing but inside diameter of the hub, so small d, and this will become outside diameter of the hub, that is 2d we are taking from this relation. So symbol is capital D we are taking, that is, and dimension will become 2d, that is the standard proportions from we are taking. So if you see here, so inside diameter of hub is nothing but small d, that is nothing but dia of shaft, and outside dia of hub is the symbol we are taking it as capital D, and this is 2 times of D from the standard proportions, you can see here. And next one is length of the hub. So this will become length of the hub, so that is also from the standard proportions we are taking it as 1.5 times of D, that is L is equals to 1.5 times of D. So these are the proportions, standard proportions we have to take, and we have to check for the induced stress in the hub portion. So here, what kind of stress is induced in the hub portion? If you see, if you treat, I told that you have to treat this as separate part, and if you are treating this as separate part, so from here to here you have to take as hub. So that is, so this hub is treated as hollow shaft, and when you are giving the torque input, so when it is giving the torque input, it is trying to rotate. So when it is rotating, shear stress is induced in the hub portion. So that shear stress we have to find out. So you know that torque. So you have to treat this hub as a hollow shaft. So a hollow shaft transmitting the torque. So you know that torque formula transmitted by a hollow shaft, that is pi by 16 tau capital D power 4 minus small d power 4 by d. So this is the formula of a torque transmitted by a hollow shaft. So from this equation, so you know d, you can substitute d, and in the first step we have calculated diameter of the shaft, so that you will substitute here, and pi by 16 is a constant. Torque also we will calculate in the first step. So here we will find out the shear stress induced in the hub. So induced shear stress in the hub. So that must be less than the shear stress allowable. So it is less than the allowable shear stress, means these proportions are right. So this completes the design of hub. And next step, design of the flange. Design of flange. So design of flange means, see here, this flange will consist of only one dimension, that is nothing but thickness of the flange. So that is nothing but thickness of the flange. So that is also is given by standard proportion, that is 0.5 times of d. So thickness of flange tf is equals to 0.5 times of d, where d is the diameter of the shaft. So here dimension is already given. So you have to check for the stress induced. See here, so how to, where the stress is induced and how it gets failed if the stress exceeds. See here, when it is rotating, it is trying to rotating. So this is the hub portion, and here is the flange portion, which are interconnected. And when it is trying to rotating, it is trying to rotating. So this is failed at this portion. It gets failed at this portion. So here, what is the area resisting the, what is the area resisting the this shear torque? See here, if I draw like this, so this inside area is subjected to this shear, this area. So you know that this is nothing but capital D, that is outside diameter of the hub, and so this is nothing but thickness of the flange. This is nothing but thickness of the flange. So here, what is the area which is resisting this torque, or which is subjected to shear force because of the torque transmission? See here, so this is d, and this is thickness. So you will get area, this area which I have hatched here throughout the circumference, that is the area which is subjected to shear. So if you write that area, so that will nothing but pi d into tf. So pi d will give the circumference, and that circumference is multiplied by tf times, so that will give the area of the flange which is subjected to shear. So if you write that formula once again, same torque formula, T is equals to force into radius, and this is at the radius of capital D by 2. Now it is at the radius of capital D by 2, and this force we can write as stress into area, and stress here, shear stress induced in the flange portion, and area is, we have written it as, written pi d into tf, and this is d by 2. So from this we will find out the shear stress induced in the flange portion. So this shear stress induced must be less than the shear stress allowable. So you can substitute here, this is only one unknown thing. Torque we have calculated in the first step, d, first step we have calculated d, here you can take 2 times of d, and tf, thickness of the flange, this is the proportion you have to take tf, and d is once again same thing basically. So here it is the only one unknown thing. So you can solve this equation such that you can find out shear stress induced in the flange portion, and that must be less than the allowable shear stress. And here, so here in this flange coupling, we have designed the up to flange, and the last step in this design is designing of bolts. So we have we are using bolts because we are using two flanges to connect two shafts. So these two flanges are connected by number of bolts along the circumference of this flange. So if you see this how it is placed means, so the last step is design of bolts. So let us see first of all how this will be, how these bolts are placed. See, like this, number of bolts are placed along the circumference, along the circumference of this flange. So if you see, this is the corresponding diameter, outside diameter of the flange, and this is the inside diameter, and here number of bolts are placed. So in the side view, you can observe number of bolts can be placed along the circumference, that is n. So here, so first step is, let us say n is the number of bolts used to connect these two flanges. So here, how will you design this bolt means, see, when it is trying to rotate, when this flange portion, this hub and flange portion is trying to rotate, this flange is apply shear force on the bolt. Suppose assume that this is a bolt you are using here. So when it is you place this bolt in the two flanges, and you are connecting with this, we are fixing this bolt with a nut, and when it is trying to rotate, so you have placed this bolt in the flange, and this flange is trying to rotate. So this will apply a shear force on the bolt. So from that shear force criteria, you can find out the diameter of the bolt. So let us say D1 is the diameter of the bolt. D1 is the diameter of the bolt we are using. So that is if you take in mm. So see here, I told that you can find out this diameter of the bolt if you consider the shear stress criteria. So let us take this shear stress induced or shear stress criteria of the bolts. So let us say tau B is the shear stress of the bolt material. See here, so I told that in the first step itself, torque transmitted by each and every element must be same, such that these n bolts which are placed along the circumference of the flange must be transmit the same amount of torque which we are taking from the first step itself. So the torque, you can write the equation. So because I told that this bolt is subjected to shear force, see here, this, suppose this is a bolt you are taking, this is the bolt you are taking, suppose, and it is subjected to shear force in like this. So this is gets two parts. So when it is sheared off, so and the area is nothing but here, this is the area, and that is nothing but, so if you say this, we have assumed as it is a D1, and the area subjected to shear force is pi by 4 D1 square. So here, once again, torque you can write as torque equation, you can write simple equation, force into radius. So this force stress into area, and radius means these bolts are placed at a radius of D1. So this D1, I told in the first step itself, D1 is the pitch circle diameter. So D1 is the pitch circle diameter. So at this diameter, these bolts are placed along the circumference of this flange. So this radius will become d1 by 2. So this radius will become d1 by 2. So you can observe here it is a d1 and this radius will become d1 by 2. So these are placed at the radius of d1 by 2. So stress is nothing but shear stress of the bolt, and area is, we have calculated already area which is subjected to shear force, pi by 4 d1 square, where d1 is the diameter of the bolt. And so see here, this is for one bolt, and there are n number of bolts which are transmitting the torque. So this n number of total number of bolts are transmitting the torque here. So you have to multiply with n, and this is d1 by 2. So from this equation, you can find out diameter. So this, if allowable shear stress of the bolt material is known, and n number of bolts, n, if you know n from the, so this completes the bolt. So in this,
ఇంకా
అయిపోయింది, కాకపోతే మళ్ళీ ఒకసారి అండి అన్నీ అయిపోయినాయని చెప్పాలి.
చెప్పండి, 26 నిమిషాలలో అయిపోయింది, 30 నిమిషాల్లో నా చెప్పాలి.
రెడీ ఉంది, రొటేటింగ్ దిస్ ఫ్లేంజ్. వైల్ ద ఫ్లేంజ్ ఈస్ రొటేటింగ్ ద బోల్ట్ ఈస్ సబ్జెక్టెడ్ టు షియర్ ఫోర్స్. సో బై టేకింగ్ ద షియర్ ఫోర్స్ షియర్ స్ట్రెస్ క్రైటీరియా, we can find out the diameter of the shaft from this equation. And after finding out the diameter of the diameter of the bolt, we can we have to check the diameter against the compressive stress. So that is from the same torque equation. And if the compressive stress induced in the bolt is less than the allowable value, you can say that the diameter is satisfied. So this completes the design of the bolt. So all these 5 steps will combinedly give the design of the flange coupling. Thank you.